How's your weekend? There's a lot of good music that came out. What was your weekend like?
It was good. I actually went to see Flo Rida on Friday. Friday, yeah, I saw Flo Rida on Friday. That was kind of a weird concert to be at, but he sold out Aurora. Sold out Aurora, so that was decent. And he had the Ying Yang Twins before him. If you know who that is, it's the people on Get Low, and they had that one song that say that song. Like they were way better than I thought they were gonna be. And even Flo Rida, he was one of them people like Juicy J or Future. When I went to Summer Smash, it was like, I did not expect you to have this many hits, but he went for 2 hours and didn't play a song I didn't know. Like, it's crazy, bro. He went for 2 hours.
What venue were you at? Like, where was the concert?
So I honestly think it's a newer venue, because I've never seen that over there, but in downtown Aurora there's this thing called River's Edge, and mom says she saw a couple shows there, so it must have been the past couple of years that they put it up. But it's like right there by the casino, like across the street from the casino. So
that's crazy, because I you know, it's funny, I seen Tongue Guy's, I think it was his Snapchat story. Mm-hmm. I was like, yo, why is bro on stage?
I was on stage too.
No. And then I think the next morning I woke up and saw your story or whatever, and I clicked it. And I was like, where the fuck are they at? I was like, where are they even at? That's crazy that you said Flo Rida, though. That's insane.
No, they brought, he brought a bunch of girls on stage for, it was Apple Bottom Jeans, the one with T-Pain. Bro, I forgot how many songs he had. It was kind of crazy, but he brought a bunch of girls on stage, and then he was like, "All my dogs come from the crowd." And then I was trying to get over the gate. This is actually a funny story. I was trying to get over the little fence gate thing, and this couple, no bullshit, pushed me in my back, and I fell on the ground, almost hit my head, but I got like a bruise on my knee because I just smacked the ground super hard. Yeah. I got up.
I was like, why are you moshing at the Flo Rida concert?
I wasn't moshing. It was when he said, everybody come get on stage. So I tried to get over the gate and they pushed me. I was like, hey, bro, what am I going to do now? Like,
that's insane. How much was it?
It was only, bro, it was $25, bro.
That's insane. That sounded like the when, I don't know if you were at that year, I saw Pitbull at Ribfest.
Pitbull was at Ribfest.
Yes, bro. It's the worldwide. What the fuck are you talking about? $20 and unlimited ribs? That shit was fire, bro. Man. That's dope. I'm gonna have to, maybe I'll try and get to see Flo Rida, you know what I'm saying? He has to come to Jax, right? He has to do a Florida tour.
I mean, he's from Florida, I think. I think he's from Miami Gardens or something like that. So he's definitely gonna be back down there.
That's his name, bro. Flo, right? It's just Florida.
Yeah. Yeah, bro.
New music. I'm gonna let you talk about it, but did you listen to K-pop by Travis, Bad Bunny, and The Weeknd?
Yeah, bro. After I turned on that Nas album, I kind of mixed that into like what I was listening to. But if that's how Travis's whole album is gonna sound, I'm there for it. Cause he came on there, just his flow is crazy. Like, I felt like it almost felt like a mix of like reggaeton and afro beats, having Bad Bunny on there, and then even the vibe of the beat of the song. But I really liked it. I think, like I said, if that's how the whole album is gonna be, it's gonna be a real good album, like, honestly.
Yo, and I fell for the hype, bro.
What do you mean?
I fell for it. The leak, you hear a leak, the song sounds crazy. For when it drops, you're just hyped that it dropped. I listened to it every day since it came out. I listened to it this morning on the way to the grocery store, and I was like, bro, this feels like, I'm hoping this is just like an album cut, you know what I'm saying? Like, I hope it sounds better within the album. I'm not gonna lie, I'm not the biggest fan of this record. I'm not.
Why?
I just think it's like it just feels like, I don't know, bro. It doesn't feel like a good song. Mm-hmm. It doesn't feel like a good song. Like, it feels like three different people got sent a beat, three people put a verse on the beat, and then they just kind of inserted the verses in there, and there was no real cohesion between the three. The beat was crazy, don't get me wrong, and I like the way Bad Bunny sounded on the beat, but as a song, I'm not messing with it, bro. I'm not gonna lie to you. I'm just like, it's sort of like how I felt when It's Crazy came out with Jay Huss. That's why, yeah. Like that, and that's why I'm like, this could be an album cut. Like I could see like the vibe switching in the album. Like if you think like a Astroworld, how often it switched, I could see this making sense within the album and me not being mad at it. It's not a bad song, but I fell for the hype because when that bitch came out, I was like, oh my God, Bad Bunny, Travis Scott, The Weeknd. And then I sat with it for a second and I'm like, but this ain't even like, this ain't that record.
Yeah.
This ain't that record. You know what I'm saying? It's not a bad record, but it ain't that record.
I will say that I felt like it wasn't really cohesive. Like I felt like when Travis came on there, it sounded good from Travis. And then mixing in those other artists, it did kind of sound like they just kind of sent them the beat. They didn't make that song together. It was just like, yo, I think y'all would sound good on this. But I definitely think you're right about that. I personally don't know. I liked it, but I get why you're saying you don't like it. It definitely didn't sound the most cohesive, but I liked how it sounded. So I don't know.
Yeah, that's fair. I want to shout out the producer, though. I don't know how you pronounce his name. BNYX. He produced that Search and Rescue record with Drake, and then he's been working with Yeet for a while, and he was on that record. And I think there was a couple other producers on there. It was one of those records that had like 10 producers on that bitch. So I'm gonna list them off because I do like the beat. I'm not gonna say I like the beat a lot. The bounce on is kind of nice. It's Boy Wanda, Jahan Sweet, Ilangelo, and then BNYX. I think BNYX has kind of like gotten cool with Drake because he did the sound. I don't know what they call it. I think they call it like the soundscape or the direction for the sound of his of the tour. It's All a Blur. He's been working on that, so he's been working closely with Drake for the last couple months. So shout out to him. Magic 2 by Nas. What'd you think?
I really liked it. From what I heard so far, you were talking about the 50 Cent song, and that was a good song. I thought 50 Cent's verse was way too short on that. Like, I didn't even think. I thought he was gonna like get off for at least a minute, but he didn't even. He gave a quick 8 and got out of there. But
and then he talked for a minute, and then he talked for literally a minute.
Queens, nigga, rap.
Queens, nigga, we going out. We should go out because we got money.
That's what he said.
That's literally what he said, bro. But I would say my favorite songs off it were probably Motion and Irvin Magic Johnson. I definitely feel like Nas is about to have, like, if he makes this a third album out of Magic, I'm pretty sure they probably are going to do that. But I think it's crazy that Nas is about to have two trilogies that are like crazy. And he said on one of the songs, he was like, I'm in my second prime. And I think that's real true. Like he found one with Hit Boy, like found a real good producer that fits him. And he kind of fixed that narrative about him. Like he picks bad beats. He doesn't like Nas doesn't sound good over what he's doing. And I think it's really helping him through being with Hit Boy, like for sure.
I would say half the project when it initially came out. Mm-hmm. And then I listened to the whole project this morning. And then I listened to a couple of songs in between there. My favorite song on the project was Abracadabra, and then I liked Motion as well. I don't know if I'm on the fence. It's good music. It's good rapping. I sent you one of the beats earlier, and I'm like, this sounds like that Intuit record by Big Sean. Those two songs, the beats sounded really similar. And I don't know. I think I have Nas fatigue. I think five, like, it's impressive and it's good music. Five albums in 2 or 3 years is insane. The output is crazy of what he's actually putting out. And there's songs on here that I like, but I don't see myself going back to it anytime soon just because I have four other Nas projects to go back to. And I found as a new project came out, I would listen to the older one less. Like, I don't listen to King's Disease 1 very frequently. Like, the only song on there that I go back to, I would say pretty frequently, is Spicy. Out of all the projects he's released so far, my favorite was the first Magic. And then I'm trying to think, on King's Disease 2 and 3, I like the Lauryn Hill record. I like Thun on the newest one. I like Michael and Quincy. So I think of when I'm thinking about this run by Nas, I think it's going to be the, like, in 30, 40, 50 years when people are looking back at hip hop, this is going to be so important. Like, this run is going to be so important. I think what he's saying on here, like how people talk about Jay-Z's 444 and how is that important to, like, the evolution of hip hop. I think this run is going to be in that same bucket, in that same category, because it's sort of in that same vein. I just personally, for me, where I'm at and where I'm listening to musically, I don't see my, like, he's put out probably, if you add them all up, it's probably like 80 songs in like 5 years. So I don't see myself going back to many of these records, too many, but that's just from the fact that we have an overwhelming amount of music. I go back to Magic One all the time. So it's not like I'm, this isn't a diss, but I just think he's getting out as much music as possible, and then hope maybe he'll disappear or something, because who needs to put out 5 albums in 2 years or 3 years? But
yeah, he definitely could have spaced them out a little better. I'll agree with that. I personally, I don't have Nas fatigue, because I feel like I wasn't around when Nas was really on his, like, real run. And I started getting into Nas probably 3-4 years ago when you sent me Purple. And I think that's still one of my favorite songs to ever, that I've ever heard in my life. Like, I love that song. But
yeah,
I definitely think King's Disease, was it King's Disease 2 that he had? It was his face on there in the red cover. Yeah, that was probably my favorite one. I would say I go back to the most songs on that. But I think I'll go back to at least 3 or 4 songs on here. But I could definitely see you, how you have fatigue from it. Like, I personally, the artist I have fatigue from is YoungBoy, because YoungBoy puts out an album every year. I haven't listened to, like, at least 8 or 9 of them albums, and he's dropped probably 11 this year. So, like, I don't know, bro.
It's, you know, the thing about music fatigue, and it sucks, because it's like, once you lose me, you lost me.
Yeah,
you lost me, because I'm the same way. I haven't listened to a YoungBoy project since, I can't even tell you, the one that had the Lil Wayne song. It was Lil Wayne on there, and then
I think that was Top.
Yeah, that's the last project that I've listened to, and he's probably released like what, 7 since then.
Bro, it's almost 20, because bro, that was 3 years ago, and since then he's put out something like, let me look, I'll look real quick.
That's crazy though, because I liked the project. That's the thing. It has nothing. The fatigue has nothing to do with the quality of a music. A lot of times, it's just like, bro, how many of your songs can I listen to? I don't know, but yeah, another artist I say I have fatigue with, and maybe he hasn't. I don't even know if he's been releasing music, bro. But Polo G, bro. I listened to a Polo G song in years.
Yeah, he's Polo G's been putting out a lot of like records with like the pop producers too lately. Like, he just put out one this week. He put out one Friday, and I didn't even listen to it because I saw who else was on it, and I was like, I don't even, like, I'm not, I'm cool.
More singles that released this week: Too Fast by J-Rock. Did you hear that one?
I didn't hear that one. I like the last J-Rock song that came out, but I gotta listen to that. I didn't even see that came out.
He got one. It's Too Fast by J-Rock featuring Anderson .Paak and Latto. Ooh. Ooh. Anderson .Paak produced on this record, and this one go, bro. Latto got off. Anderson .Paak did the hook. This song is crazy. When I saw the names together, I didn't get it. But then you seen the video. It's a West Coast vibe. It's, bro, it's a good song. I'm not gonna lie. They all kind of did their thing.
I'm definitely gonna go listen to it. I just added it to my like song, so I'm gonna listen to it after this.
All right, I got 2 more. Bling Bling by Skilly Bang. What I will say I appreciate about Skilly Bang, and I think he not mimics Drake in this way, but he takes out of Drake's book, is that he has records for the girls and he has records for just everybody. You know what I'm saying? Like, the records that are clearly for the girls, you know. And I feel like he released a 3-pack EP a couple months ago and a couple singles since then. And a lot of those were for the girls. And you can tell because they use them on TikTok a lot. They use Skilly Bang on TikTok a lot, bro. And I thought they were okay, but they weren't for me. But this one, I fuck with this one heavy, bro. This one has probably been my most listened to song all weekend. But I'm hoping he drops the album soon. I really liked it. Check out Bling Bling by Skilly Bang.
Yeah, there's a there's so much came out this weekend, like compared to last weekend especially. So I didn't even get to catch everything. Like I was definitely focused on the Nas project. I didn't even know Skilly Bang put out another song. I don't know how I missed that.
Yeah, I don't see him promoting, and I don't know if this is intentional. I don't see him promoting music like that. Like I see him doing stuff on the back end, like if it's posted. I don't ever know when a Skilly Bang song is coming out. Ever, unless it's a feature. Like I knew he was going to be on WizKid's album, but that's because WizKid was promoting it. And then when the album, the tracklist came out, he reposted it. I don't see him like doing any pre-work. I see him doing post-work, but not pre-work. I don't know if that's intentional or not, but he's on RCA. So RCA, do something about that. Because why do I never know when a Skilly Bang song is coming out?
I feel like a lot of artists are like that, though. Like, I feel like some of them aren't great at promoting themselves. Like, some of them have teams, obviously, to promote, but they're not sitting there putting in the groundwork to really promote. Like, hey, I just put out this music because I feel like maybe it's like they think they're so big that it won't matter. They will get that promotion. They will get that push. But I feel like you definitely still got to, like, put it out to the people because you might just catch somebody that day that didn't even know that you were putting out music.
I follow a lot of my favorite artists on Spotify. So on Friday when the drop happens, like you have release radar, which gives you the playlist of all the songs that come out. And then you also have the little notification button up at the top, like on the home screen. So I don't really miss, there's very few times where I miss my favorite artist releasing a song. It doesn't really happen like that. But sometimes I'm surprised. And when it's a really good song, I'm like, you should have promoted this a little bit more. You know what I'm saying? Because like you said, there are people who don't have the following or who aren't following them on Spotify or another platform. So we'll see. But check out Bling Bling by Skilly Bang. Taliban's 2, Burna Boy. This is turning into a Burna Boy podcast. I'm not going to lie to you. Every week I have something to say about Burna Boy and I have no regrets because I love Burna Boy. I love his music.
I mean, that's why when I bought you that poster, I knew you was going to instantly love that poster.
Yeah, bro. The apartment is like 85% done, bro. My rug came in yesterday. I put some posters up. But yeah, Taliban's 2. Did you listen to it? What did you think? Did you see the music video?
I didn't see the video, but I did hear the song. I like the song. Burna Boy's verse was real good on it. I definitely think if it would have released earlier in the summer, or that would have been like the original song, it would already be song of the summer. But I think it's getting to that point where it's like, you know, it's late. But I hope that the guy whose song it is originally, I hope he puts out like another full album soon, or like in the next year or two, so I can like really tap in with him more, because I like it.
He put an album out earlier this year.
I know.
And Taliban's was. Do you listen to it?
Yeah, I listened to that album. That's when I found out about it, because you sent me Taliban's and then I went through and clicked and I saw he had released the album. So I listened to most of the album.
Oh, okay.
I understand. I want more music. Like I know the Taliban's right now. He's riding this fact that the single is about to be is one of the biggest right now. And he's gonna ride that out until can't do it no more. But I definitely want to hear more music from him, like different vibes or just like more of his style. I don't know.
Yeah, Taliban's 2. Burna Boy, Byron Messiah, the video. I have a couple of things to say about this, bro. The video was confusing. It was good, but the video was confusing. Why is Maxo Cream in the video? We don't know. Why is Santan Dave in the video? We don't know. But I fucked with the vibe. It was dope. You know what I'm saying? I like that they were in Jamaica for the vid. I definitely think the vibe is not the exact same as the original. I mean, that's the point of a remix. And so if I have to pick one or the other, the original or Taliban's 2, I'm going with the original. I'm going with the original. I like Burna Boy's verse on it. He got off. I'm going to go back to that one. But I will say if you listen to the song, the momentum of like the initial 45 to 50 seconds of the record, it's like da da da, like it like builds the song up, and Burna Boy just comes in like rapping crazy, And I'm like, this is a different vibe. And I'm not saying I don't like it. I'm just saying it's a different vibe. So I like the record. As I told you, he spit the Jada Kingdom bar in the verse. It was going viral on Twitter for sure. I seen a lot of people tweeting about it. And I think it's going to do what it's supposed to do. It's got 1.4 million views on YouTube already. It's got 350,000 streams on Spotify as of this morning. We're recording this on Sunday. So I think it's doing what it's supposed to do. As I said last week, they pushed the button. They're just trying to get this as much visibility as possible. And I fuck with it. So Taliban's 2. There's two leaks from Burna Boy that I seen this weekend. Swiss Beatz played the song he has with Burna Boy, and I fuck with that heavy, bro. There's been a bunch of, you look at the images of people like out with other people. He's been out with Swiss Beatz a lot. And then he was out with RZA. He played that Top of the World song with RZA. And if he's getting production like that, like the song that Swiss played, this album is going to be nuts. This next album, Big Seven, it's going to be crazy. There was another leak that came out yesterday, a J. Cole and Burna Boy song on the next album. That sounded kind of like J. Cole sounded like he was about to get off. It was like a quick 16 seconds, but he mentioned Burna Boy, so you don't know what actually happened. But I know J. Cole got off on that. And I said on Twitter a couple weeks ago that I think the reason Burna Boy is having so much more success than Wizkid and Davido is he has more of a Western appeal than any other Afrobeats artist. You know what I mean? I think he talks about he spent a lot of time in London for a couple of years, and he talks about that a lot. And I think you can just hear it in the way he makes music. I think like the way he speaks, it's more, and I don't want to be this guy, but it is more understandable to people who might not know a lot of Nigerians or might not know a lot of West Africans. You know what I mean? Everybody speaks differently, and a lot of people are ignorant to how other people communicate. And him spending that time in West London, in London, not West London, I think that helps with just how he delivers on a record, and it makes it easier to understand him to people who might not understand people from that area. So I think if he's now working with a lot more Western producers, Western artists, like on the last album, he gave us a little bit of that. He's been doing that for a while though. Like he gave us that Future and Burna Boy record a minute ago. On this last project, he gave us a Blast and Kehlani song. Like he's been slowly but surely making his way into like the American scene, but working with people like a Swiss Beatz, or I hope, yo, we get a RZA Burna Boy song. I would love that. Yeah, but I think Big Seven is going to be nuts.
I feel like if you go and listen to what even you hear outside, you'll hear more Burna Boy than you'll hear some of the other Afrobeats artists. Like I'll hear them mix it in the sets just because I feel like his music kind of fits.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I think that he's more frequently worked with those artists who are who are not in his realm technically. Like you said, that Blast and Kehlani song, I love that song off the album. And I think Top of the World, you said you didn't like it originally, but I thought it was decent. And wasn't the burner we was looking for, but yeah. But I think that even was him testing the waters with a more Western style song, using an Aaliyah song that he sampled, but using that song to then make another song sampling. Even you, the use of samples, like I feel like you're gonna hear more raw instruments and just like pure instrumentation in Afrobeats and stuff like that, but him using a sample from us or using a sample from a US artist is different than what you see. But I would definitely say this next Burna project is gonna be crazy.
To that point of having more Western sounds, I guess it is his advantage that he wasn't first in terms of the Afrobeats wave in America, right? Like the first two to be signed were Wizkid and Davido. And I think like when you're first here, you get to fuck up the most because you don't know like what's going to work when you get here. I think Burna Boy having more of a slow burn, it's like he watched what was going to work. And then he caught one overseas with Location. And so he was like, okay, I see what's going on. And then he catches another one with Last. So he just has more opportunity to test before he became this big star. You know what I mean? He has a crazy fan base. Anytime I post about Burna Boy on any platform, it gets crazy visibility. Like we have 27 followers on Twitter. I posted that video and it got like 100 retweets and like 400 likes and about 10,000 views or something like that in 3 days. The video I posted about him selling out that stadium. We have no, you know what I mean? He has just so many fan pages and stuff like that on TikTok, on Twitter. And that just goes to show the fanfare that he has. And Big Seven on the way. I'm going to say it every week. Just Big Seven on the way. So be on the lookout for that. Drake and Central C on the radar freestyle. Combination. Combination. What'd you think?
Drake wants to be Jamaican so bad, bro. Like, it's so funny. But I liked it, bro. Like, Drake, I always like how he will dip into those other areas, and he's all really like creative with his artistic expression. He likes to just step outside of his like normal box or whatever. And I feel like that. But at this point, it kind of feels like that UK vibe is in his box. Like, the way he be doing it, bro. Like, but yeah, and I do think it's great that he started working with Central C too, though. I hope that they have an actual song together too. Like, I'm waiting for that.
I think they will. I think this is promotion for whatever he has coming. I think a lot of people say, I don't think people understand. If you're not from Toronto, you wouldn't understand. But Toronto's probably just as diverse of a city as New York. Uh-huh. It's probably just it's just as diverse of a city as New York. It's like London in that same way. And so when you hear Drake talk about like why he wanted to be a part of Top Boy, like why he wanted to executive produce on Top Boy, he said he knew people that, like the people in Top Boy gave him a similar vibe to people he grew up with or people he knew in Toronto. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's just a lot of West Indian culture and there's a lot of West Indian culture in Toronto, and there's a lot of West Indian culture in London, and that influences a lot of the rap and the music there. So it, like, him on the UK thing, it's on the UK thing. It has like, it makes all the sense in the world. And I hope this is promotion for a real record, because I'm not gonna lie. I'm probably not gonna go back to the freestyle too much because it's just a freestyle. But if they give us a real song, I'd be happy about it. I saw Mimi the blogger, the music blogger, she said something on Twitter that she thinks she could see Central C getting a Grammy nomination just because of the camp that he's in with. I'm going to send you the clip because it was interesting the way she was talking about how, in terms of a mainstream act getting cosigns from the UK, he has probably the most credible to become like that mainstream label act. Like, if you look back at the people who prior to him have had the American cosign, you have like Skepta. Skepta was like cool with ASAP Mob, but it was weird with Skepta because I feel like he started really hitting his wave in terms of like, how do I say this? I think his prime musically in terms of like becoming a popular act was before he started getting American notoriety, like mainstream notoriety, right? And so I think by the time that the music, like people were ready for that type of vibe from overseas, he wasn't really like the rapper anymore. He still raps, but you know, like when you're in that peak of like, yo, I'm trying to become a big artist. I don't think he was there anymore by the time that America was ready for more global sounds. So I think that Central C has just right place, right time. He's putting out good music. The Drake cosign is the biggest cosign. You know what I mean? It's so crazy the amount of Drake cosigns we've gotten in the last year. Ice Spice, Sexy Red, Central C. What the fuck? But, you know, shout out On The Radar. I think, you know what's funny? Because the only On The Radar freestyles I've ever watched are the Ice Spice one and the Central C and Drake one. I don't really watch On The Radar like that. So shout out them, though.
How often do you feel like you really go back to freestyles? Like, I feel like the only one I'll actually go back and be like, I want to sit through this whole thing is like Russ's. Like Russ's on, what's that, LA Leakers? That was a really good freestyle. But I feel like those freestyles, I never really go back and I'm like, oh, let me go watch a on the radar freestyle. Let me go back and watch a LA Leakers. I feel like I don't do that very often unless it's like on Spotify or something.
I go back, and I think that's the advantage of some platforms, and it's smart. Some platforms will put the freestyles out mm-hmm. on Spotify. I think the one I go back to the most in recent memory is the J-Hus Daily Duppy freestyle. Okay. It's 5 minutes, and I know like half the song. I know the entire song. I was in this bitch rapping that shit yesterday. I was just in the crib rapping the J-Hus Daily Duppy yesterday. Some of the colors, I guess colors performances are different because they're not freestyles.
Yeah.
Freestyles though, I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't really think there's many.
Thinking about that while you was talking about it, because you said, "Oh, I'm probably not gonna go back to it." I was like, "How often do we really go back to freestyles though?" Like,
I go back to that Black Thought freestyle sometimes.
Yeah,
on Funk Flex. The Lil Russell 2021 freestyle. I go back to that a lot. Mm-hmm. I like that one a lot. I'm just looking through my likes now. That's pretty much it. That's pretty much. Oh, they took it. Yo, I hate when you going through your likes and you see that they took a song down that you liked. Mm-hmm. Bro, they took down the Jay-Z Big L freestyle. That was a radio freestyle, and I used to listen to that one a lot. But they took that bitch down.
Isn't that the one Joe Budden used to play? Yeah, that one was hard.
Yeah. But the Sway, I don't go back to this one too frequently, but the Sway in the Morning freestyle. LaRussell knows to put everything out on Spotify. But yeah, you're right. We don't really go back to freestyles that much. So I think there is a record out there. I heard that there was Doja Cat. She said that Central C was on the Munch remix. And she just put out the deluxe. And Central C was not on the deluxe. So I don't know where the record is.
Was there a remix of Munch on there? I didn't even look at the deluxe, bro.
No, there wasn't. And that I saw she was putting out a deluxe. I assumed it was going to be on there because she had an interview like a week or two ago saying, yeah, when I put out Munch, I had a remix with Central C. I was like, bet. But it never came out. So Ice Spice dropped the remix. Dropped the remix, bro.
You got to drop that remix.
Spotify is raising its prices from $9.99 to $10.99 after YouTube also raised their price to $10.99. It's a dollar. I still think we're criminally underpaying for every song to ever exist, but people are complaining. What do you think about this dollar price hike, you broke ass nigga?
I don't think that it's really going to affect as much as I thought. I think they're still going to have just as many subscribers and just as many people on there. I don't think it's really going to... I think they just did it because somebody else in their same market did it. I think they were just trying to compete. But I think also that Spotify, I was hearing that they were trying to find more ways to make money, and they need to find more ways to make money. And I could see this being one of those ways, kind of like how Netflix did the whole... like you can only have a certain amount of screens and stuff like that. I think they're just trying to like adjust with what the market is doing.
I'm mad. So I'm leading this saying Antonio led the podcast saying that he was going to get rid of Spotify because they raised it a dollar. Get your money up, nigga.
No, that's hate, bro. I don't like pitch.
Whatever. Hybe share price. Yo, I've talked about Hybe on here twice. Do you know who Hybe is?
No.
Hybe is the company that owns... They were a music label initially, but now they're a music company. They owned BTS, okay. The big K-pop group. Hmm. They started Hybe America. Hybe America is the group that bought out QC, Quality Control, mm-hmm. for $200 million. You might have seen that a couple months ago. The CEO of Hybe America is Scooter Braun, who was the music exec. He was the manager of Taylor Swift for a while. He was the manager of Justin Bieber for a while. And so they're in a global takeover right now. If you don't know, a lot of people probably don't know this, but BTS has been on a break for about a year and a half now because I forget how many of them, but one or two of them was enlisting in the army just because it's required by law over there. And so they had like disbanded for a little while. And the strategy that the company decided to go on was releasing individual albums for the ones who weren't going into the army, and then also expanding into other markets with other artists. And I talked about them. It was a week you had missed a couple of weeks ago, about how they had an album from an artist do really, really well in South America initially, and in the it was a Chinese Mandarin artist, and the album did really well in South America. And so what they decided to do was release the album completely in Spanish.
That's smart.
And it was because it was doing well in Mandarin. So they released the album in Spanish, and I just thought it was interesting because the way that they have strategically grown this thing is insane. Like, this article I'm about to read you about their stock price, I did not know they were making so much money. The year before, well, the year BTS disbanded was, I think, the end of 2021 or the beginning of 2022. In 2021, they made $1 billion, the entire company. And they said that it was projected that BTS was going to account for 45% of their revenue, $450 million just from that one group. Yeah. And so I'm going to get into the article a little bit just to talk about how crazy the numbers they're doing are without BTS, like without the actual group. HYBE's plan during BTS military hiatus, it explained, was twofold: to build what the Korean firm called a multi-label strategy that would develop new superstars outside of BTS, and two, to rely on solo releases of BTS members such as Jimin, Jin, Suga, and Jungkook to satisfy BTS fans until the group reconvened in 2025. Yet this plan presented by HYBE CEO Jinwan Park evidently didn't fully reassure shareholders of HYBE, which has traded on the Korean Stock Exchange since October 2020. On October 13, 2022, in the same month that HYBE confirmed BTS's hiatus, and the same month Jinwan Park presented HYBE's post-BTS plan, HYBE's share price hit an all-time low, sinking to 109,500 KRW, which is that's their currency over there. Mm-hmm. And I'm not about to do a currency exchange thing on here because this is a music podcast. But that was down close to the quarter of HYBE's all-time peak share price, which is 400,500 KRW. So keep that in mind. It dropped to 109,500 when they said that they were going on hiatus. And their high was 400,500. So last week they released a song called Seven featuring Lotto, like the Lotto from America. And this was the most streamed collaboration song on Spotify of all time.
Crazy.
The only songs, period, like not even collaboration songs, the only songs to have higher streaming days than this song Seven is Easy on Me by Adele, Antihero by Taylor Swift, Lavender Haze by Taylor Swift, As It Was by Harry Styles. So this song had 15.995 million chart eligible streams, right? That is a hazy term because Spotify doesn't they don't tell you how they determine if it's a chart eligible stream, but they do release this data on these singles. This song was A&R'd by Scooter Braun of HYBE America. There's a bunch of stats on here, and most people aren't going to care about the majority of them, but I want to just make sure people are paying attention to HYBE's global takeover. The fact that they bought into the American market in such a big way, like they own QC. You know what I mean? Lil Baby's on QC. Yachty is on QC. These are artists we are familiar with, but they're implementing strategies globally that other music companies are not as fast to do. I think that's one thing that really stands out about me. When I see them in headlines, they're very nimble and agile when making business decisions. Like, they saw that album in South America was doing well in Mandarin, and within 2 months they lied on a press release and said she taught herself Spanish and made the album in Spanish. She didn't teach herself Spanish. They got 10 other people to write it for her. I'm not mad at it. I'm not mad at that. I'm just saying the fact that they were able to do it in such a quick amount of time shows you how they're making so much bread. And they literally just started with one group. They started with BTS, and now they're almost a multi-billion dollar company. And so I think in this new world, I'm taking it past music at this point. Like, if you understand the internet and you understand how things grow in this way, you can grow to a billion-dollar company in 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years if you have a good strategy and you understand the market. Like, I think what Hybe is doing is insane right now. And I think it's a good case study for anybody trying to build a business in music or trying to build a label, because they've built this group to a $500 million group, and they're going to bring them back in 2 years.
Yeah, I mean, I'm honestly going to see if that's on the American Stock Exchange too, because BTS, bro, like, they have the, it's not, okay, but either way, they have the craziest fan base. Like, they really have like a cult following, and I know that people are sitting there really waiting for their music, because even I went to La La last year, and one of the dudes who was in BTS, he had his own performance. Like you said, they broke up and they're doing solo stuff. I saw one of the dudes in concert. Bro, there were people there. The concert was on Sunday. There were people there right after, I think it was J. Cole that was on Saturday. Right after J. Cole ended, people sat down and waited for that BTS guy. And he wasn't even until the next day. He was the last set on the next day. So I'm sitting there. We were like, we had asked some of the people, like, what are y'all doing? They were like, oh, we're waiting for this dude. And they were like, isn't he tomorrow? They were like, yeah. Two people were like sleeping there waiting for this dude. You got in the crowd. Everybody had these like special lights that the dude on stage, they're all connected to, because when you like buy BTS packages or whatever, when you're one of their fans, you pay for something and they send you like this light, and it like goes with the performance, bro. Like, he'll say something, the light changes color, like it'll go red, it'll go blue. Like, it's crazy how that group and those people are doing music right now. Like, I think they have one of the biggest cult followings in the world, to be honest. And they're probably going to be like, that 45% of their revenue makes a lot of sense, honestly.
That's so crazy that, you know, and watching it come from that part of the world, I feel like here, because of our, and we talk about this on this podcast a lot, and I think that's what, like, we're building this on, but the American bias we have prevents us from learning so much more. And not even just learning about other people, it's just learning about the world in general. Mm-hmm. Like, I think about even, like, Sheen. When I was in school, one of my marketing professors was talking about how Sheen, I don't know if it was a marketing professor or where I heard this, but I started looking into it, and basically Sheen is not a clothing company. Sheen is a data company, a data analytics company that happens to sell clothes, right? They have such a good understanding of their analytics and what it takes to sell something that at a certain point, it's like they're so proprietary about their data, and that's what's really driving the growth. And there was no Sheen like 7 or 8 years ago or 9 years ago. And that's what I mean. Like, they were just so growing so astronomically fast that they just have an understanding of like data and analytics and psychology in a way that, I just read an article last week on how super fans are the most under monetized group in the music industry right now. Like, we're looking for more ways to monetize music, and the people who are streaming the music the most, listening to the music the most, the most active listeners, these are the people you need to be targeting to make more revenue, right? Like, you've heard of the theory, it's like you need like 1,000 true fans, or the thousand real fans, like that theory, where it's like your most rabid supporters are the ones you're going to make the most money from. And this, like, that light example is something crazy that I didn't know about. I'd never heard of it. And so I think there are a case study for everybody. Like, if you're looking to have success in music, I think that's the way to do it. On the other hand, though, what I was thinking about when reading all these numbers, like, they're so data analytics focused that it has me wondering, what is it going to, like, is anybody going to listen to this music in 10 to 15 years? Like, I listened to that 7 song prior to this, and the lyrics almost feel AI written. They almost feel like, you can't say they're for sure written by AI, but they feel formulaic. Like, they're using like they're using lyrics from older songs that people will remember, like very catchy parts. And I'm just like, this did well on the first day, but what is it going to do 5 years from now, 10 years from now? Right? Like, this is when we talked about the other day, the differentiation between music as content and music as art. This type of stuff falls more on the content business side to me. And that's not a bad thing, because I think the people who do it as art can take things from the people who do it as content to get more people to listen and to get more people to like really pay attention. But at a certain point, it's like, is this just the money grab for right now? Like, is anybody going to listen to this? We don't know until time passes, but right. It's one of the most interesting things in music to me right now.
Yeah, I definitely think there's a lot more people making music for content than music for art. Like, I feel like even like we talked about earlier, Youngboy, like I feel like when you get to the point where you're dropping 10 albums, 12 albums in 2 years, it's more so for content, to get it out there, like to get your name and face out there, instead of like, I like to make music, I like to make quality music, and that's what I'm focused on. Like, I feel like those artists never really get that shine, bro. Like the real musicians, that's why you, I feel like that's why you saw a person like Andre 3000 just start walking around playing a flute, because he didn't want to deal with all the extra stuff, bro. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, he was over it, bro. He was definitely over it. But I think that's it for this week, bro. We had a lot of technical difficulties. I'm gonna let all the stuff upload, and hopefully it's not too crazy to put together. But do you have a song for us this week, bro?
Yeah, I do. I didn't talk about this album. Babyface Ray put out an album on Friday too. I really fucked with it. I'm trying to remember which song I wanted to talk about. Pretty sure it was called All-Star Team, I believe. All-Star Team by Babyface Ray. I love the beat on there. I feel like Detroit itself, like every artist in there, whatever producers they working with, they're doing a real good job of the sampling. Like when they use samples, older samples, I feel like they have a really good grasp on it. Maybe because, I mean, they come from Motown. They come from those, like, the real musicians back in the day. But I would definitely say, go check out All-Star Team by Babyface Ray. Check that out.
This week, my song of the week is Loyalty by G Herbo off the 25 album. Yeah, almost shed a tear this week, bro. We didn't talk about it. Hey, nah, we're not wrapping up yet. I got to talk about this because this is that nigga G Herbo. But G Herbo has pled guilty to fraud charges with Designer Puppies and all this other stuff, bro. But it's crazy because for the last 4 or 5 months, if you follow G Herbo on Instagram, he's been posting like 2 to 3 times a week. Yo, all business owners, all artists, all this, all that, all talented this. If you're talented, leave him in the comments. Hit me up. This, and that. That's all he's been doing. He ain't been putting no music out. And I noticed this like after the first time, I'm like, oh, he's just trying to diversify investments. That's what that is. When I seen it the first time, this was like 5 or 6 months ago, bro. And then he kept doing it. And I'm like, bro, I'm like, there's something going on here. This was prior to the announcement. I'm like, something's going on here, because there's no way, like, it's almost a desperate look for people who need, like, you're looking to put your money, you're looking to park your money, bro. That's what he was looking to do. He was looking to park his money in some other places. And I'm like, this doesn't make sense. This makes no sense. And then out the fucking blue, Mans is charged with potentially 20 years. Bruh. And I'm sitting here thinking back to his last 2 or 3 years. I remember when Mans got arrested, got out, put the song out. He put the song out. Statement. If you know, you know. Go check it out. I was so blue, bro. I was so blue. G Herbo is almost 10 years in this, and I feel like he has yet to write his best rap. I feel like he's, and when you feel like an artist is there, bro, like that's where we're at with J. Cole. J. Cole has yet to write his best rap. Every rap he releases is better. It's better and better. It gets better and better. And I feel like we hit that with G Herbo. And now this nigga going to jail? What the fuck?
I just feel like there's a real issue in rap music. Like, I feel like every time I start to like an artist in rap, they either die or they go to jail. And I feel like there's just like a real issue with, I think it starts with the fact that artists aren't getting paid well enough. Like, if they were getting paid well enough based off of what they're making these companies, then they wouldn't be sitting here doing stuff like wire fraud and feeling like they need to go get, like, change their name, do all this stuff. Like, it's definitely sad to see, but it's consistent in hip hop. Like, it's just what it is. I feel like it's kind of consistent in the Black community. Like, you're putting people in these positions where they feel like they have to get to it or they have to do this. And even I saw him after you sent me that, I saw him posting like all this stuff, like, business owners hit me up and like doing this marketing and reposting people's stuff, and I'm sitting here like, you could tell he's getting to that point. Like, it don't look good. It don't look great.
I'm not about to geopolitical this shit out because this is a music podcast. I have to let y'all know this. This is a music podcast. But rap music has been used to target the Black community since it became a mainstream thing. If you go back and look at when it started, bro, it was people from the streets, but it wasn't this type of messaging. Somewhere along the lines, it was no longer ours. It was no longer ours. And people coming from communities like where Jirbo is coming from are just falling victim to it consistently. And I'm not about to get too deep into this, but bro, that shit made me so sad for about an hour, bro. I was like, fuck. Like, he's finally in his prime. He hitting his stride. And then that shit happened. Yeah. But go check out, go listen to his music, stream it up, Loyalty by Jirbo. We getting the fuck on, bro. We getting the fuck out of here. Hey, man. Episode 16 of the Rhythm and Rhymes podcast, bro. Free that boy Jirbo, bro. Bro, my heart hurt, bro. We'll see y'all next week.